Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to welcome you to a subcommittee meeting of the Military Personnel Subcommittee of the House Armed Services Committee. Today we'll be taking testimony regarding hazing in the military. The committee will come to order. Today, the Military Personnel Subcommittee will receive testimony from the service's senior enlisted advisors concerning the service's policies, training, and enforcement with respect to hazing. This is a topic that cannot be taken lightly. Hazing is a degrading act that must not be tolerated in the military or in our society. Unfortunately, it happens. The military services do have policies on hazing to ensure its members understand it is wrong and must not be tolerated. Hazing is contrary to the values of our volunteer force and affects the morale of units. It violates the professionalism achieved and expected by our military. The subcommittee will hear from the senior enlisted leadership within the services who are charged with keeping the service chiefs informed. These leaders are also responsible for ensuring the service member at the lowest level not only understands these policies, but also knows the courses of action that service members should take to remedy the situation when policies are violated. This issue concerns me as a member of Congress, as a veteran myself of the Army, National Guard, and Reserves, but especially as the father of four sons who are currently serving in the military, where what we want is the best environment for what we know is an opportunity of military service. I would like to welcome our distinguished witnesses, Sergeant Major of the Army, Raymond F. Chandler III, Master Chief Petty Officer of the Navy, Rick D. West, Sergeant Major of the Marine Corps, Michael P. Barrett, Chief Master Sergeant of the Air Force, James A. Roy, and Master Chief Petty Officer of the Coast Guard, Michael P. Levitt. Ms. Davis is our ranking member from California. Would you like to make any opening remarks?
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm very pleased that the subcommittee is turning its focus to the important issue of hazing in the military. Over the past year, there has been a number of hazing incidents across the services that have been brought to the public's attention. And I'm sure that we would all agree that hazing is a serious and deplorable crime. It disrupts unit cohesion and reduces the morale of our men and women in uniform. And it can, as we know, lead to tragic consequences. Hazing, particularly in light of the current ongoing deployments and responsibilities that are being asked of our men and women in uniform, is a very serious matter. I'm aware that most of the services have policies that prohibit hazing and harassment for that matter. But I am interested to hear how the services educate and train our military personnel so that they know how to recognize hazing and harassment and what they should do to stop it or prevent its tolerance among the force. Do we even know how often these incidents occur? If incidences are not tracked, how does a service even recognize that this is an isolated incident or an epidemic? Parents and families who send their son or daughter to serve our nation in uniform are already concerned about their health and safety, given the operational requirements service members are facing. They should not have to worry about whether their child is being subjected to hazing or harassment as well. So we need to restore the confidence in our families that the services are doing all that they possibly can to prevent hazing from occurring among the force, and hopefully this hearing will be one step toward that goal. I want to welcome our witnesses. We thank you very much for being here, and I certainly look forward to hearing our most senior enlisted members of the services present to us today. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Ms. Davis. Without objection, I ask that statements from the Organization of Chinese Americans and the Asian American Justice Center be included in the record of the hearing. Hearing none, so ordered. I ask unanimous consent that other committee and non-committee members, and I want to welcome Congresswoman Judy Chu of California and Congresswoman Nidia Velazquez, to be present, also Congressman Honda, thank you for coming too, as you're just entering, that the three of you be allowed to participate in today's hearing after all subcommittee members have had an opportunity to ask questions. Is there any objection? Without objection, non-subcommittee members will be recognized at the appropriate time under the five-minute rule that each of us has applicable. Sergeant Major Chandler, we will begin with your testimony. As a reminder, please keep your statements to 3 minutes. We have your written statements for the record.
Thank you, Chairman. Mr. Chairman, distinguished members of this committee, thank you for the invitation to address you on this issue, which concerns all of us associated with the United States Army. Let me give you the bottom line up front. Hazing has no place in our Army. We will not tolerate hazing in any form, and we will hold those in violation of this policy accountable for their actions. I spend about 270 days out of the year traveling around to post camps and stations throughout the world, visiting with soldiers and families, and discussing a wide variety of topics. My overall message to the force is the Army profession. I talk about what it means to be a professional, how soldiers should conduct themselves, and more importantly, how they should treat each other. To be a professional, our soldier must possess the three C's: competence, commitment, and character. The first is easy to spot. Competence means you are doing your job and doing it well. Commitment and character are not so easy. A soldier who is committed to the Army and has character lives the Army values at all times, even in the absence of peers or leadership. Soldiers who lack character, commitment, or competence are not the type of individuals our nation needs to serve as part of our Army. We have a duty as professional soldiers to maintain the trust and confidence of the American people, not just to fight and win our nation's wars, but also to maintain high professional and ethical standards. So when a soldier behaves inappropriately, Congress and the American people expect the Army to hold that soldier accountable. For 237 years, the Army has worked hard and successfully to strengthen that bond. We must also continue to train and educate our soldiers and Department of the Army civilians on the effects of hazing in our ranks. The vast majority live the Army values and are truly professional. However, even one incident of hazing means we are not doing enough. I can assure you the Army has taken a strong stance against hazing. Hazing is not compatible with our Army values and will not be tolerated. The American people trust we will hold perpetrators of hazing accountable for their actions, and we take that trust seriously. I, along with the Army senior leaders, am committed to fight hazing until there are no such incidents in our Army anymore. Our soldiers, families, Department of the Army civilians, and the American people deserve no less. I appreciate your time and will answer any questions you may have. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, and we will now proceed with the testimony of the Master Petty Sergeant Rick West.
Chairman Wilson, Ranking Member Davis, and distinguished members of this subcommittee, as the Master Chief Petty Officer of the Navy, I am honored to have the privilege of representing more than 427,000 active and reserve sailors who comprise the finest total force in the history of the United States Navy. People are absolutely our most precious asset. Their individual success and the Navy's collective mission accomplishment lie in our ability to provide an environment that promotes inclusiveness and a validated sense of value to the team. Maintaining a positive command culture that fosters these ideas is a top priority of our Chief of Naval Operations, for me personally, and for leadership at all levels. Hazing unequivocally destroys these ideas and is not tolerated in your Navy. It is inconsistent with our core values of honor, courage, and commitment, and detrimental to the individual esteem and unit cohesion. The Secretary of the Navy's instruction on hazing is the cornerstone of our approach to education, prevention, enforcement, and accountability. Training on hazing, equal opportunity, and core values begins with recruits at boot camp and is reinforced regularly in a variety of forms throughout a sailor's career. We also emphasize and actively train our force on bystander intervention as an effective measure to prevent numerous offenses, including hazing. There is no plausible excuse for a lack of awareness on the Navy's hazing policy, nor any legitimate explanation for violation of a policy explicitly intended to protect the health and welfare of our people. Navy policy requires commanders to formally report every suspected incident of hazing to the chain of command as soon as possible. Every sailor has a responsibility to make the appropriate authorities aware of hazing. All reported incidents are fully investigated, while the rights and needs of victims and witnesses are immediately addressed by the chain of command. Those who commit violations of the policy and those in leadership positions who may tolerate such acts are held accountable. We understand people are truly the singular measure of the Navy's success. We appreciate your passionate interest in protecting their welfare, and we stand committed to meeting your expectations. I look forward to your questions, sir.
Thank you very much, and we proceed now to the Sergeant Major of the Marine Corps, Michael P. Barrett.
Thank you, sir. Chairman Wilson, Ranking Member Davis, members of the committee, I'm grateful for the opportunity to appear before you today to discuss the important matter of hazing in our armed forces. The individual Marine is our greatest asset. So let me be clear, hazing is not a part of our service culture or who we are. Our official policy states that hazing is contrary to our ethos of taking care of our own. It violates the virtuous conduct and soldierly repute earned by Marines who have served the Corps honorably since its inception. Hazing fosters a climate of maltreatment and cruelty, concepts inconsistent with our core values. As leaders, we naturally want Marines to be successful and maintain the desire to stay in our Corps. As an institution, the only way that the Marine Corps can exist, survive, and thrive is through fostering a climate where Marines have every opportunity for participation and advancement in accordance with their talents, backgrounds, culture, and skills. The positive contributions of our Marines bring us mission success. The Marine Corps aims to transform our nation's youth not only into ethical warfighters, but into better quality citizens. As we do so, we expect to confront matters of hazing, arising sometimes from the indiscretions of youth. The Marine Corps recruits from young demographics, and it is well documented that the Marine Corps is the most youthful of all the service branches, with 63% of the force aged 25 years or younger. Unfortunately, hazing can manifest sometimes in organizations that conflate immaturity, youth, and arduous responsibility. In such an environment, young people sometimes might confuse hazing with the means for belonging or a rite of passage. As an institution of more than 202,000 personnel, the Marine Corps is not perfect. No institution is. Yet we rely on our 236-year legacy of honor, courage, and commitment to help us address problems like hazing when they arise. Hazing is a behavioral problem and a form of misconduct for which we must remain vigilant. The Marine Corps works diligently to charge behaviors, to change behaviors and mindsets into an effort to foster better judgment, especially among our junior leaders. As the Sergeant Major of the Marine Corps, I tell our Marines throughout the entire Corps that every Marine deserves to be in a good unit, led morally, ethically, and professionally. And as such, Marines are products of our leadership. Engaged, dedicated leaders must display those enduring trust qualities: competent, committed, consistently dependable, of the highest moral and ethical character, and team mentality. There is no greater a compliment than one to say to another, I can count, I can trust you always. That is our end state. Hazing has nothing whatsoever to do with being a leader and is not taught as a leadership tool in any period of instruction in our schoolhouses. Those engaging in hazing do not act with the Marine Corps' blessing. The Commandant and I are disgusted with that kind of behavior. Thank you for this opportunity to appear before you today, and I look forward to your questions.
Thank you, Sergeant Major. We now proceed to the Chief Master Sergeant of the Air Force, James A. Roy.
Chairman Wilson, Ranking Member Davis, and distinguished members of the subcommittee, thank you for an opportunity to speak on behalf of the more than 500,000 men and women who comprise of the finest Air Force our nation has ever seen. Today's airmen are highly motivated and better qualified to conduct our missions across the globe than ever before. Regardless of where they serve and what they do, none of our airmen can complete this mission alone. Each of us needs a wingman to help make sure this job gets done. Our service's most precious commodity is our airmen. To protect them, we create and promote a culture of respect and dignity. Airmen are exposed to human relation training early and often, starting with recruitment, basic training, continuing through separation and retirement. This training makes it clear that activities like hazing will not be tolerated. The Air Force holds leaders responsible for creating a safe work environment. However, we believe all of our airmen are leaders, and therefore we hold all airmen accountable for recognizing conflict and intervening as necessary, especially in less formal settings. Although the Air Force does not have its own policy on hazing, the DOD's definition and guidance is implemented through our subordinate commands. Our accession sources have adopted the DOD's definition to appeal to the target audiences. This allows us to impart on our airmen that hazing will not be tolerated and serves as a foundation for the culture and respect and dignity we build starting at accessions and continuing throughout an entire career. I'd like to thank you again for your continued support and concern for our airmen and their families.
Thank you very much for being here today. And we conclude with the opening statements with Master Chief Petty Officer of the Coast Guard, Michael P. Levitt.
Good afternoon, Chairman Wilson, Ranking Member Davis, and distinguished members of the subcommittee. Thank you for the opportunity to appear before you to discuss issues related to military hazing. I, along with all the leaders in the Coast Guard, am responsible for ensuring our personnel are treated with dignity and respect. Hazing serves no purpose and is contrary to our core values of honor, respect, and devotion to duty. The Coast Guard's hazing policy is found in Discipline and Conduct Manual, released in October of 2011. The policy defines hazing and clearly states that consent does not eliminate accountability. Hazing can be punished under provisions in Uniform Code of Military Justice, and in severe situations may result in court-martial, fines, reductions in rank, jail sentences, and or punitive discharge from the Coast Guard. Hazing typically occurs in connection with unofficial, unsupervised initiations or other informal rites of passage and are not authorized in the Coast Guard or unit policy. In those cases, offenders seem to target junior personnel. Prevention of hazing can best be achieved through training and strong leadership that is engaged and is involved at all levels. This will help ensure the culture across the Coast Guard is intolerant of hazing. We are constantly striving to improve our organizational culture and our workplace environment. For example, every 2 years, the Coast Guard conducts a comprehensive survey of the workforce called the Organizational Assessment Survey. The results consistently show the Coast Guard is rated strong in several key areas, such as communications, diversity, leadership and quality, supervision, teamwork, and work environment. We will continue to monitor trends in these key areas in order to prevent and eradicate inappropriate behaviors such as hazing. All personnel must understand that hazing will not be tolerated and no one may consent to being hazed, which is an important part of our policy. Training of all Coast Guard members occurs during recruit training and annually thereafter. Awareness and support of hazing policy has been emphasized by senior leadership. The Commandant, as well as Pacific and Atlantic Area Commanders, have recently released messages regarding hazing, sending a strong and clear message to the workforce. Leadership courses for our prospective commanding officers and officers in charge, as well as our boat forces command cadre positions, include training on hazing, thus ensuring future leaders understand and enforce the policy. So as I close, let me emphasize that the Coast Guard places the highest priority on preventing hazing. We have strong and clear policy, extensive training, effective leadership, in an environment within the Coast Guard to ensure our members are treated with dignity and respect. It is essential to eradicate hazing so old Coast Guard members may fully contribute to mission success. The people of our great nation deserve nothing less from us. So thank you again for the opportunity to testify today, and I look forward to answering any questions you may have.
Thank you very much, and thank each of you for being here today. This is a real honor for me to have not only members of our subcommittee, but we have three other members who are very interested and rightly so in this very, very important issue. And so it's an opportunity to have very dedicated members of Congress here on this issue. We will have a 5-minute rule, and I appreciate Mr. Craig Green, the professional staff, will be maintaining the time, and we will be proceeding with each person of the subcommittee and then our visiting welcomed members. At this time, my first question is, I believe that hazing contradicts the, as has been stated, the service's core values. there are policies and training that attempt to prevent hazing. I'm interested to know, beginning, and we'll start with the Army and go to the Coast Guard, how you, as the senior enlisted members of the service, emphasize through the NCO chain that hazing threatens the effectiveness of your service and will not be tolerated.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Recently, we have published a letter to all members of the service about hazing. The Secretary of the Army, the Chief, and I have tri-signed a letter to reemphasize the Army's commitment to prevention or elimination of hazing. Within training, we do that within the initial military training environment through basic training through the United States Military Academy. The Army does not have a formal policy or training program at the unit or individual level specifically focused on hazing, and we are actually reconsidering whether or not we need to make some adjustments in our training program.
Throughout the life cycle of an average Marine, and we'll say the average Marine is 4 years because 75% of our cohort gets out every four years. But in that four-year time frame, every single Marine will go through not less than or a minimum 11 times they will receive value-based leadership and value-based training. From the second they step on the yellow footprints at Parris Island or San Diego to the time they go to their infantry training battalion for the Marine combat training, all the way to when they step into their MOS school, and then when they get to their first unit, they're welcome aboard, and then they receive annual training all the way through to the service or the rank-appropriate EPME academies that they will attend. So through the life cycle of an average Marine through 4 years, a minimum of 11 times, they will receive their training. We have also refreshed and re-energized our policy order that more clearly delineates exactly what hazing is that was not in our old order, and we have re-engaged and we've re-energized our leadership to take that forward and take it down to the lowest level.
Sir, thank you. For the Navy, it's a continuum of training from the time that individual starts into boot camp into that individual is out of the Navy, essentially. But we reinforce that at all levels, at all times. We do that through a variety of mixed training, from the classroom-type training to individual-based training, i.e. GMT, general military training. We also have the levels of training associate at our command leadership schools, which our COs, our XOs, department heads, and our command master chiefs receive that training as well. We check that as well throughout a sailor's career by various means, such as a CMEO survey or Command Managed Equal Opportunity survey, or through various visits to the fleet, which we receive feedback. And also now, as well, social media is a powerful tool which we're able to get indicators that are out there. But it's a continuum, sir, and we'll continue to press forward on that. We do have a policy in place that is out there. It's very clear to our leaders, and it's very clear to our sailors.
Again, sir, thank you for the question. Just like others have stated, ours begins at accessions, whether it be officer or enlisted, begins at accession. It goes through professional military education. It also touches on those command billets. Every time that somebody gets prepared for a command billet, it's touched on as well. And then also one area that we do a little different maybe is during expeditionary startup training. We also provide it there, and we do annual training as well. Some of the ways that we measure its effectiveness is obviously through the surveys of the IG and others through travel of just visiting the units, commands, and such.
Mr. Chairman, I'd echo the same with a lot of my other peers here. We all have. But we got our training starts in recruit training, as I mentioned in my oral statement. And then as we push through the service, there's a certain level of maturity that you increase when you try to figure out what the core values mean. When you come in at 18 years old, it might be a little bit different as you're adjusting to the Coast Guard. But it's really important for the senior leadership to understand what these values are and what they look like. And so our training programs to look at our command cadre, take a look at what your command climate is. And one of the key things of that is really focusing on your leadership at all levels and understanding what hazing was just another one of the behaviors, because you have other things out there too, but hazing is definitely detrimental to your command climate. identifying what those things are in a training. But at the end of the day, training is a great thing. We have all those things in place. It's what we do on the front lines and how we take care of those things and then how we hold those things accountable.
And as we proceed to Ms. Davis, I would like to point out that I always found it helpful at armories, at dining facilities, to have posters identifying that hazing is not tolerated and what I would hope that it could indicate the chain of command of if you feel like you've been hazed, what to do, and that there would be a follow-through. But I just, as a suggestion, I always found it very, very helpful. Proceed to Ms. Davis.
Thank you. Excuse me. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And I wonder if we could just assume for now that a majority of incidents are reported, and you can speak to that, and perhaps that's really not the case. But if we have a number of incidents, how do you track that? How do you really watch those incidents over time? And do you are there any statistics that would indicate what happens as a result? Disciplinary action, punitive action, whether court-martial. Are there stats to demonstrate that? And you know, how vigorously, I guess, do you feel that represents the situation that we have before us? You all want to?
I can go first. From the Army perspective, the challenge for us is that there's no punitive or statutory title for hazing. There are many for other forms of misconduct, but there isn't one for hazing. So if you want to do a search, which, you know, the Army has started to search through all of the previous records of judicial punishment to determine, you know, we do have some statistics. I'm not comfortable with the quality of the statistics because you have to really drill down into each one of the charges to see whether or not it was an assault, which may have been a fisticuffs, or if it was an assault that you can then turn to hazing. However, what we do have is that since 2006, we have 71 cases that may meet the criteria for hazing, which involved 139 subjects and 123 victims. Of the 139 subjects, 65 received some administrative, judicial, or non-judicial punishment, and 43 are still pending adjudication. 21 have no action taken. So I'm not positive that is a final answer, but it is a preliminary search of where we stand, and I think the titling question and whether or not we have a specific specification for hazing may help us to better identify this.
Thank you.
We have just presently started with the new order that has been delivered, that has been sent out by the Commandant of the Marine Corps. We are now starting to track in our case management system and our SJAs, hazing specific, any allegations or confirmed cases of allegation are immediately reported through our operational reporting systems, and they are reported directly to the Commandant of the Marine Corps. So we have now a tracking system in place that we didn't have before. And I concur with exactly what the Sergeant Major of the Army said. When it comes down to the particular criteria, when you look at Article 92, disobey of a lawful order, or cruelty or maltreatment for Article 93, or 128, assault, you have to drill down to find out those things that may have caused that to lead to a hazing incident. And I also concur with the Army with what he said, that maybe hazing as another element inside the manual for court-martial be specifically delineated as a way ahead.
Ma'am, from a Navy perspective, our Secretary of the Navy instruction of 2005 has directed us to all substantiated incidents of hazing be reported via op rep or sit rep to our CNO. Now, we also have recently started tracking all incidents of hazing via a quarterly criminal activity report via our JAG. With that, since 2009, we've had 46 reported hazing incidents, an average of 15 a year. 20 of those 46 resulted in punitive, administrative, or disciplinary action. Also with that, we drill a little deeper in it. We've seen no injuries occurred because of the incidents, no suicides or suicide ideations was reported in association with those incidents, and race was not a reason or cause for any of those incidents as well. The majority of these were physical incidents where most of them were senior to junior, characterized as horseplay activity associated with promotion or qualification achievement.
Again, as others have stated, inside the non-judicial punishment, there's not really a label per se to pull down. However, we do track through our IG system. We have tracked since 2005, 21 different incidents. Of that, one being substantiated. The others, as we turn them to command and they report back to us on which actions were taken, again, one of them being substantiated.
Since, ma'am, since 2009, we've had 9 court-martial cases that we keep track of, and 7 of those cases occurred at one unit. So it was congregated at one area, and the other 2 others. Some of these cases were still pending, so we're going to wait for that, but that's where our numbers are sit at right now, ma'am.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you very much, and we now proceed with Congresswoman Madeline Berdayo of Guam.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I thank all of you gentlemen for being here this afternoon. I have just a couple of questions, and any of you, please feel free to comment for your respective services. We know that each service seems to have a zero tolerance for hazing, but it is still occurring. Can you tell me how hazing has been dealt with in the past, the lessons that we've learned over the years, and have you employed today more effective ways to combat this type of behavior? How is it different today than it was yesteryear? Could begin with whoever would like to begin.
Ma'am, I will tell you, I've been in the Navy since 1980, signed the papers, and I can tell you from then to today, it is night and day in comparison. We have put several corrective measures, as I previously stated, into place. We are constantly talking about it. In fact, this particular year, I instituted a policy called CPO 365, and it kind of goes back to the CPO or the Chief Petty Officer inductions that we've been doing for many years. Those of the past were behind the closed doors and probably not a thing that we would we'd be proud of. Those today, it's a training opportunity. It is more so of a training evolution, and we put things in place that teach our sailors our core values and our history and heritage.
Go ahead.
Yes, ma'am. We have also heightened our awareness this situation. 31 years of service, I have seen cases of hazing that have come before me as being in a leadership position. I've seen them adjudicated. I've seen those who wrongfully committed the violation. I've seen them held accountable. I've seen it at the NJP level. I've also seen it at the court-martial level, and I've also seen it where it was something as simple as a Marine pushing a Marine, where it was at a more of an administrative counseling level. So I have seen it at every single level, and I've seen convictions, and I've seen the wrongdoers held accountable. There is a heightened awareness in the United States Marine Corps. We have changed our orders, and we have made it more, like I said, we have made it more detailed to truly explain and wash away gray area.
Thank you.
You know, from an Army perspective, ma'am, I came in the Army roughly the same time as Master Chief Petty Officer Rick West did, and I stood on the back deck of my tank on Grafenwehr, Germany in 1982 and was promoted to PV2 private. And at that time, it was very common practice to have the backing taken off of your rank and basically people punch it into your skin. And that was a common practice throughout the Army. That is not a common practice today. You call those blood stripes. Another measure that used to happen in the past was a gauntlet, where soldiers from the platoon would line up on either side, and as a soldier walked by, they'd punch him or her in the arm. We don't tolerate that anymore, and that really started to change back in the mid-90s, really, when we realized that those types of behaviors were not in keeping with who we say we are as professional soldiers. I believe, and my experience in the Army is that we do not have large incidents of hazing throughout the service, but we still have incidents like have happened here recently that cause great concern. And so we have not completely eradicated it. And our commitment, my commitment, is to see that that happens. And until it is, I'm very concerned.
Thank you.
If I could just add to that, ma'am. I've only been in for 30 years. we haven't had the blood stripes of sort as been described. But I will tell you, based on the culture of the United States Air Force, based on the values that have been published and believed amongst all airmen, and I think one other key point, and Master Chief said it earlier, is this idea of bystander training is so important that it's not just the member, but it's also those that are around those members that should say something as well, should they see something. And that has really kind of capped it off for us.
Go ahead. Anyone else?
Yes, ma'am. I'd like to answer up. I think in the Coast Guard, we just updated our discipline and conduct manual, which does a much better job of defining the elements of hazing. I think that's a great tool for our leadership to look at and for all our members in the Coast Guard. And then the second thing is, as soon as the Commandant and I took over this job, the Commandant updated all our policies to reflect those elements, which hazing is one of those elements, under respecting our shipmates, mm-hmm. under one of his four principles. And then he sent a clear message to the field under several other issues, unethical behaviors, and hazing was one of those. And talks about how those types of things undermine our morale, which degrades our readiness and damages our mission performance. I think those are critical elements of pushing forward on in regards to hazing.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman, in interest of time, if I could just one question, and one of you could answer this. It's important to me. Given the recent incidents with Asian Pacific Americans, how are the services learning from these unfortunate experiences and applying lessons to avoid these problems as we go forward in implementing Don't Ask, Don't Tell? If just one of you could perhaps answer.
Ma'am, I will tell you from a Navy perspective, we constantly train to, one, the policy, two, we take incidents such as those and those that happen in our Navy, and we make them case studies. I was just up in Newport, Rhode Island, where we teach our commanding officers, our executive officers, and our senior leaders, enlisted leaders, and they will go through a basically walk through an incident from A to Z to make sure, one, they understand it, two, what would they do. So it's trained to, and more importantly, it's enforced.
Thank you, and thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Ms. Bodayo. And we now proceed to Congressman Mike Kaufman of Colorado.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm somewhat worried by the direction of the discussion here. If we think that this the problems that recently arose with the two Asian Americans was a function of hazing, and that was all that we have to deal with, I think we've really missed it. I think what we really fundamentally have at the end of the day is a failure of small unit leadership, is a failure of NCO leadership. When you're in a ground combat team, that there is no stronger interdependent bond that happens. And so what we have is really, in a sense, a soldier, and I'm less familiar with the case of the Marine Corps, but who was rejected by his fellow soldiers. And you had an NCO, probably you had a squad leader, might have a fire team leader, I can't remember how the Army's organized that way. But you had a squad leader, you had a platoon sergeant, you had a first sergeant that either knew about it and did nothing or should have known about it. And that, for somebody who's never been in that situation, who's never been a part of a ground combat team, could never realize how difficult that is when you've been rejected by that team and you're there. And so I think that if we say that if we've corrected hazing and we don't deal with the psychological component of this, we've really missed the mark. This is much more about physical hazing. This is really about a fundamental failure of leadership at the most basic levels. And I'm just really stunned by it all. And I do have to ask one about the United States Navy a question, and that is that I saw a media report about some sailors who were recently disciplined for a hazing incident being deployed aboard ship, and it was caught on some sort of observation cameras, and they were discharged. Am I correct in that?
Sir, that is absolutely correct. There were eight sailors that were charged, taken. Matter of fact, it was investigated, and they were charged. The CO took them to mast. There was a battery of disciplinary actions, one of which they were all discharged from the Navy. Yes, sir.
I have to say that, you know, we're going to find our way here. But I do think that's an let me tell you where that's an overreaction. That should have been, they should have been disciplined. It should have been maybe Article 15, maybe summary court. I don't know the specific circumstances, but we're really, we're going beyond correcting it, this problem, and politicizing it by saying to those sailors with one incident, if I understand the article I read correctly, that we're going to, what kind of discharge did they receive for that incident?
General discharge, sir. I would also say that I rely on the chain of command. The chain of command was there. They investigated.
Right.
And those leaders on the deck plate, which I wasn't there to see, they applied the discipline as they seen fit on the deck plate.
And that took place after all the congressional concern that was expressed publicly. And so, but I have to, I've questioned that. But I just hope that in particularly in the Army and the Marine Corps, well, in all the services, I served in the Army and the Marine Corps, but in all the services, that we have certainly better leadership that ought to recognize these. And we just had an incident in Afghanistan where a staff sergeant went and killed 16 civilians and has practically derailed our policy. Where was the leadership there in recognizing that this person was starting to go off kilter? You know, where was that leadership? Where was the leadership for PFC Chin? Where was the leadership in Lance Corporal Chu? It was missing. That's the fundamental issue. It's more about the lack of leadership by the NCOs than it is about the conduct of the junior enlisted in these alleged hazing incidences. Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
Thank you very much. And we proceed now to Congresswoman Nikki Tsongas of Massachusetts.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and welcome to all of you. And I appreciate very much your testimony. And I appreciate, again, the efforts that you all are putting into this. But I have to say, as I listen to it, there's a deja vu quality to it. This committee has spent, this subcommittee and the broader Armed Services Committee has spent much time addressing the issue of sexual assault in the military. And over the course of my tenure here in Washington, which has not been that long, but I know even in the years before, there are many instances in which you all or representatives of the service came to talk about the policies you were putting in place to address the issue, the training you were putting in place to address the issue. But the reality was that despite all those good efforts, in returning visits, it would become clear that there were many, many shortcomings. So as you deal with this issue, I would encourage you to put in place metrics, objective ways of measuring the outcomes of all this hard work that you do. And I support also what my colleague, Mr. Kaufman, has said. In that instance, as well as in this one, it's clear that the role, the leadership role, the role of the command structure is very, very important, and that there have to be accountability measures built into that as well. So really, just to make a statement, I thank you for your testimony. I appreciate the hard work, but it should not be spinning your wheels, and we have to find ways to make sure that that is not the case. But thank you for being here.
Thank you, Ms. Tsongas. And we now proceed to Congresswoman Judy Chu of California.
First, I want to thank Chairman Wilson and Ranking Member Davis for allowing me to attend this hearing today. I've been trying to get a hearing on this issue for many months, and I'm grateful that you're focusing on this critical matter. And the American people are watching. In just a few days, I've received 2,097 letters and petitions from concerned citizens calling on us to do something about hazing. And these are the petitions right here. I ask unanimous consent to submit a letter summarizing these petitions for the record.
Without objection.
Thank you. Today's hearing is just a first step. I hope the committee will continue to work together on this issue in the coming months. I have a personal reason for being here. My nephew was a victim of hazing, and it killed him. Hazing is a serious problem in the military, and though the military has policies in place, they aren't being enforced and they aren't effective. Just last year, Private Hampson Daniels McPherson, an African-American stationed in Okinawa, faced a near constant racist hazing by his fellow Marines. Finally, he set himself on fire and died. Last year, Private Danny Chen was hazed for 6 weeks. He was dragged across gravel until his back bled. Rocks were thrown at him to simulate artillery. He was called gook and chink. Finally, Danny shot himself to death. In 2010, Black Army Specialist Brashan Anderson was pushed to his physical limit for weeks. He was made to build a sandbag wall with no purpose. He was called dirty and forced to wear a plastic trash bag at all times. Finally, he could take no more. He went to the latrine and shot himself to death. And then there's my nephew, Harry. The Harry that we knew loved to joke and in fact was known for his skills in breakdancing. At age 19, he enlisted in the Marines and was sent to Afghanistan. On April 3rd, Harry was found asleep on duty. At 11:15 p.m., his sergeant cursed at Harry loud enough to wake up the rest of the Marines, announcing that peers should correct peers. At 12:01 a.m., the hazing onslaught began. Harry's peers took it upon themselves to administer justice and corrective training. They berated him and ordered him to dig a foxhole, to do push-ups, crunches, and planks with his heavy full body armor and a 25-pound sandbag. They stomped on his back, kicked and punched him, and poured the entire contents of a sandbag onto his face and in his mouth. It lasted a full 3 hours and 20 minutes. Finally, 22 minutes after they stopped, at 3:43 a.m., Harry climbed into a foxhole and killed himself with his own gun. He was 21 years old. And what punishment was given? Virtually nothing. In Harry's case, three Marines were charged. One Marine was given just 1 month in confinement. Two were found not guilty by a jury of their peers, fellow Marines. The platoon just had a big celebration for beating the charges, as we saw on their Facebook. All of them are free to continue with their military careers, be promoted, and continue their behavior. Even a jaywalker would get a worse punishment. When I talk about Harry, the reaction from the outside versus the inside is like night and day. The outside is horrified, but from the inside of the military, the top brass usually says, "We prohibit hazing. We do not tolerate hazing. These are isolated incidents. We are perfect." But the rank and file soldier, almost to a person, usually says, "Hazing is necessary to correct bad behavior and keep soldiers strong. Better one person die, even at the hand of his fellow service members, than compromise the entire unit safety." Why do I know people say this? Because I heard them say it at the jury trial over and over again as a defense for those Marines. And I saw it in the letters to the editors, and I saw it in the blogs. This is the attitude that is in the military, and it's pervasive. So here's what I say. You cannot know if these are isolated incidents because none of you even keep records on hazing. In Harry's unit alone, there were 6 previous cases of hazing within a year. Do you think you can't do better, that losing a few soldiers' lives here and there at the hands of their fellow soldiers means you are doing everything perfectly? If there is no culture that tolerates or encourages hazing, then why did these men die for no reason? What are you doing, if anything, to change the culture of hazing and institute what I think is necessary, a zero tolerance policy on hazing that actually holds soldiers accountable?
If any would like to answer.
Well, first of all, I'm personally disturbed by hazing. Okay, I'm appalled and I'm disgusted by the actions of soldiers who I, as the senior enlisted leader for our Army, are here representing. I don't poo-poo this. I don't think that it's something that should be cast off or given any kind of, you know, wash away or hand wave. This is important things because it is about who we say as we are as professionals. When a young man or woman is hazed, it's not corrective training. It's abuse. and there is a significant difference between abuse and corrective training. Corrective training, when applied properly in the Army, means that it's tied to a specific training deficiency, and the leader is there with the soldier making sure that the training deficiency is overcome and that the corrective action is in line with that. So, for example, if I show up late to a formation, then I would my leader may ask me to come or demand or order me to come to my next place of duty early in a specific uniform. And when I've met the standard that applies to that training deficiency, then we go on about our business. From the Army perspective, from my perspective, this is not something that we're going to tolerate. And I am committed, along with the rest of the Army leadership, to solve this problem. It is against who we say we are. And if one man or woman, one of our brothers or sisters, dies because of our own actions, that is not okay with me. And I'm committed to this.
I am echoing every single thing that the Sergeant Major of the Army said. We are taking as an aggressive stance and fight towards all disgusting societal issues and concerns that are plaguing the services. And I'm not talking just about hazing. I'm talking about drugs, alcohol, domestic violence, criminal mischief, sexual misconduct, hazing, operational stress, force preservation measures, hazing, and suicide. We are taking aggressive stance. We have aggressive, our behavioral health program has integrated every one of our programs at Headquarters Marine Corps to better synchronize the research, the resources, the policies, the training, the prevention, and the treatment for all these things. I refer to them as the insurgents inside of our wire, and it's affecting every single service sitting at this table. We are aggressive. We are constantly taking and making assessments, and we are going after a problem when we see the problem. Ma'am, what happened to Lance Corporal Liu is disgusting. The small unit leadership that the congressman was speaking of 10, 15 minutes ago, he is absolutely spot on. The small unit leadership failed. I wish I could take it all back. We should have done better. But we are aggressively attacking these societal concerns as hard as we could possibly take them, and you have our assurance on that, ma'am.
Thank you, Ms. Chu, and we'll proceed to Congresswoman Nedja Velasquez of New York.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Chairman Wilson, and Ranking Member Davis. Sirs, our immigrant community is truly something that makes our country great. In New York, where I am from, this community has always been our strength, drawing not just from all over the world, but serving as a magnet for young people in this country. As I go to the various parts of my district, whether it's the Polish community, Chinatown, or some West Indies communities, the pride they show in their country of choice, is inspiring. This is especially true with the young people. It's not a surprise that they will want to show that pride through serving the military. Or in the military. I have attended over 100 of the induction ceremonies, seeing the young men and women as they are beginning their military careers with the American flag in their lapel, beaming with pride is inspiring. Private Danny Chain was one such excited young people. He was my constituent, embarking on a new chapter of his life, serving this country. He had a true love for this country and wanted to give back. So imagine the shock he felt upon arriving at this unit to find he was not only unwelcome, but the focal point of systematic torture, an act that can only be described as appalling. The result caused us a very special young man who had so much to offer. What is important to understand is when we have these acts take place, they don't just impact the individual or family, they impact entire communities. As I talk to family, friends, teachers, and those who knew Danny, I keep hearing a familiar refrain: how could this happen? And while I appreciate all the discussion of the policy on hazing and the difference it will make. I need to hear how the leadership of the military and services, of all services, going forward is going to make this policy part of everyday life, just like a soldier formation, so it's second nature. This cannot be another paper policy stacked up on a bulletin board or discussed one day and forgotten the next. So my question to our representatives from the military is, what mechanisms will be in place to ensure that there will be regular top-to-bottom reviews to ensure the policy that we have heard about today is implemented properly and becomes part of our armed services' everyday life? And I heard your anger, I heard your frustration, and your commitment. I need to hear what is the mechanism that will be in place to make sure that this is part of every soldier, men and women's life, day life.
Yes, ma'am, and I appreciate your sentiments. We have established a working group. The director of the Army staff, Lieutenant General Troy, has directed a working group between TRADOC, Forces Command, the Army National Guard, and the Army Reserve, along with the Army staff, to do a comprehensive review of our current policy, to look for gaps that are associated with our current policy and training programs, and then to look at either changes to our Army policy or to request changes to the DOD or even up through members of Congress if we need to have a statutory change to ensure we have the enforcement mechanisms we need. From a training perspective, you know, we are going to look at how we train this across the Army and whether or not we need to insert it as a special topic as a mandatory training like our Marine Corps and Navy brothers have done. And that is our commitment. We will have a program. We are in the very early stages, but I expect a very rapid turn. The Secretary of the Army has demanded swift action, and I believe we'll have it.
Sir, and you getting input from different immigrant communities?
I'm not sure about that, ma'am, but I can take that question for the record and get your response.
Thank you, ma'am. First, one of the significant purposes behind us integrating all of our behavioral health programs into one single area so that there's that crosstalk. So we're looking for that common thread to improve our value-based leadership training curriculum from the second you enter the military to the second you decide to walk out a better citizen. Next, the Commandant of the Marine Corps has just directed, and it's starting with our sexual assault. He has just instituted a sexual assault prevention operational planning team consisting of 20 senior officers and 20 senior enlisted leaders headed up by a two-star general. And the purpose of it is to take a fresh, unconstrained look at the problem that sexual assault, the programs, the courses, and the initiatives that we presently have, and how we are going to beat this back and get all the prevention to the left of the incident. And we are going to assess what we're doing presently and what we need to do to get to the left of the problem. The next thing is early this summer, the Commandant is holding a leadership symposium where he's bringing in all the three-star level leadership this summer to capture every single lesson learned over the last 10 years for the appropriate and the right way ahead.
And thank you very much. And we'll proceed with Congressman Mike Honda of California.
I want to add my thanks to Chairman Wilson and Davis and to the gentleman here. Thank you for your service, and I appreciate, as Congresswoman Nydia Velasquez had indicated, your sentiments. But just by listening to the testimonies, I would think that this hearing is almost unnecessary. Each service appears to denounce hazing and has safeguards to prevent it. Yet, hazing occurs, as evident by the recent incidents of Private Danny Chen, Lance Corporal Harry Liu, and aboard the Navy vessel, the Boehm Richard. In fact, Secretary Panetta just issued an anti-hazing directive during this holiday message in December. It keeps coming up. What I find extremely troubling is a lack of actual statistics on hazing. And how can anyone be convinced that a problem doesn't exist or current policies are working if there is no method to monitor or evaluate it? And do any of the services have a database or other monitoring system to record the incidents of hazing and harassment. I read the reports. It appears that the Coast Guard was the only one that turned in some data on the incidences and the outcomes. But what I found interesting was that that needs to be talked about, I guess, in each category of areas. Suicide had no data available to determine hazing was or was not a contributing factor. Need to dig deeper into that and to see, you know, if there is any connection with the breakdown of the racial background, you know, with white, Asian, Black, Hispanic, others, looking into the dynamics of diversity, language, and background and cultural issues needs to be dug even a little bit deeper. How does each service evaluate the current policies, if they're working or not? Waiting to review policies after a slew of tragic cases is not an effective preventative approach. I know that, and I've heard that abuse versus corrective training. I'm not sure how corrective training is put together or whether having these kinds of things looked at internally without an external review from other folks who are familiar with these kinds of practices. A few years ago, we were part of the Port Wayne Amy training for the folks over there, both civilians and enlisted folks. And we did a lot of work on racial interaction, and there was a lot of work to be done within the ethnic groups and outside the ethnic groups. So I think that that kind of thing needs to be continued. The hazing of servicemen and National Guard company assigned in Kosovo surfaced only last month after a private in the company lodged a formal complaint. Lieutenant General Mark Herling, commander of the U.S. Army Europe, commented that the private reporting the incident was courageous. In fact, the general said, for this guy to say what you guys are doing is wrong, courageous is an understatement. I definitely agree. However, it also speaks to how difficult for subordinate servicemen to report inappropriate behavior to the senior officers. I'm not sure that we're not looking into that more. To say that this is what you do, this is the process, and not understand some of the barriers or some of the dynamics that enter into reporting. And as a vice principal of middle school, you know, my kids say, I don't want to be known as a snitch. Translation, I'll get my ass beaten. Okay, so I think that that's the kind of dynamics that we may want to look at. However, this must be nearly impossible during an extended forward operation that these folks are involved in. So what can be done to create an environment that allows for this type of reporting, both psychologically and physically being able to report that, whether it's through information or through sharing, whatever it is, but it still has to be an environment that's safe and confidential. What have you done to address cultural sensitivity and to adopt a more intentional diversity and inclusion effort? And do hazing and harassment training, monitoring, and enforcement policies need to be uniform across the services? And so those are the kinds of thoughts I have, and I appreciate the other members here and their thoughts about leadership in the smaller units. I think that that's part of that dynamics too. So there's insulation between those who needed to be reported to and those who are victims of bystanders. I think that you have this the sense of who the actors are. It's the interaction and the motivation or the encouragement or the sense of responsibility to fulfill that which you say you are instilling in each and every service person. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'll wait for my response. And by the way, Mr. Chairman, these responses could be turned in writing within a couple of weeks. That would be appreciated.
Congressman Ashley, thank you very much, because the time is up, except for one thing. I thought that you actually provided an extraordinary summary. And so for the record, for each of you, I thought the points of the Congressman were well made. And I know we would all look forward to receiving response to that question. And in consultation with our ranking member, Again, I want to thank all of you for being here today, your commitment to our country, your dedication, and we look forward to working with you to address this issue in the future. We are adjourned.